Mark.
Mark?
Fiona.
Fiona Holmes. Yeah, when you first called out and I looked across, I thought you were somebody I knew because you looked like somebody else.
Familiar face, common face. Yeah.
Not common. Yeah. Have a chat to you? Can we sit down?
Sure.
Mark and Fiona.
Yeah.
Your morning coffee.
Yes.
Yeah, well, we meant to both. We're both normally at work at this hour of the day. We had to see our account this morning.
That's work.
Yeah, well, it is for me. 15 years of... Yeah. Well, I paid tax, but I just haven't bothered claiming back for 15 years. So we had to go and sort all of that out.
So your accountant is going to be able to fix that?
Yeah. Yeah, he's a good bloke. He's a very professional sort of person.
Now, what's your relationship?
Well, we're common law husband and wife.
Right.
Getting married in January, actually.
Yeah.
Yes?
January next year.
Was there something that made you do that? To make it formal?
Yeah, I suppose. Formal commitment.
Yeah.
But the commitment was made a fair while ago.
How long have you been together?
5 years now, living together.
Yeah.
7 years all up.
Yeah.
Yeah, met and sort of dated for the first couple of years. Yeah. And
You didn't work together or anything?
No. No, actually.
Close.
Yeah, she worked in a building. She worked in a building across the street from where I worked, and I kept seeing her through the windows.
Yes.
And then one day I held up a sign saying, "I think you're cute," across the street. And
I'm going.
Had you ever noticed him before?
Yeah, because he kept staring at me.
And then after doing that for a couple of days, I held up a sign with lunch and a question mark after it, and what's your phone number?
And did you write it on a sign?
Yeah, I held up the phone number.
When you first actually physically met, can you describe that?
I was surprised because she's a bit shorter than I thought she'd be. Like, I didn't know, because the angle that I was looking was...
You couldn't tell how tall she was?
No.
Yeah.
And I was a bit taken aback. But, I don't believe that that
we
can't
tell how short she is. Fiona probably
5'2".
Standing.
No. You're standing.
So then we went out and had lunch.
And there were liquid lunches at first.
Yeah, that's true. Because I used to finish at 1 o'clock in the afternoon.
What were you doing?
I was a radio operator for a cab company.
Uh-huh. You finished at one, had this long lunch. What were you doing?
I'm a pattern maker in the fashion industry. So, totally opposite.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, and it started out as liquid lunches and progressed from there.
And it obviously, you clicked.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
yeah.
When was the second date?
Oh, not long after.
We just kept having lunch, didn't we?
Yeah. Pretty much.
And then it progressed to dinner.
Yeah.
And then just went from there,
Were either of you in a relationship at the time?
I just split up from one, but you were still sort of semi in one, weren't you?
A relationship prior to this one was 7 years long, but it was in the dying throes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yeah, so.
So it was good timing, actually.
So there was nothing too dramatic to dislodge.
No.
It was very easy.
Are you still in the same line of work?
No, I gave that up and went back to driving for a living as a courier. Yeah.
That's what you still do?
Yeah.
And you're still in fashion?
Yeah, I'm freelancing now.
Yeah.
And then in the future I'd like to have my own label. I'm getting that woven up in the next couple of months.
Your own label with clothes attached to it?
Yeah.
Now, you don't only work in different fields.
We are totally opposite.
Yeah?
Like, totally opposite. Like, you wouldn't believe how opposite we are.
Well, he keeps his toothpaste tube really nice and smooth and flat, and I just scrunch mine. So that's why we have two.
And she always puts the toilet roll on opposite to me. And
I put it with the piece running over the top, and Mark's put it with the piece running down at the back.
I'm with you, Fiona.
All right. That's the correct way, Andrew.
A hair question.
Thought so.
How long have you had the hairstyle?
About 2 years.
Right. Do you do it yourself?
Yes, I do.
Right. Have you thought of giving him a similar hairstyle?
No, because he wouldn't wear it. He normally has long hair.
Oh, yeah?
And I'm either bald or got his hair.
What do you think, what's the thing for you about that style?
Well, I got sick of going to hairdressers and getting done. Oh, no.
Yeah,
so he normally has long hair. And then I was looking for a different hairstyle.
Did we get that?
And I sold that to a wig maker and got $70.
Really?
Yeah.
That's very smart of you.
Took it to a wig maker and sold it for $70. Thought I need some extra cash.
How did you cut it off?
They did it.
They did it. You just walked in
they
and
just
said,
grab it and hack it.
Uh-huh. Yeah, they sort of took a length and then they just, and I didn't realise because they didn't show me a mirror after they'd taken it all off and it was like everywhere. It was all different lengths and I jumped on the bus and I'm, and everybody on the bus was like, look at this guy's hairdo. You can see it, it's like, oh, I'm not talking to him, he's weird.
Very much like to meet your dog.
Certainly.
And if that means meeting you first, that's fine.
Scott.
Andrew.
Scott James. Hi, Andrew. This is Boswell.
I'm sorry?
Boswell.
Boswell.
Yeah.
That's an unusual name for a little dog.
Bosie.
Hi, Boswell. You speak?
He's just playing coy. Yeah.
What is he and why is he called Boswell?
He's a Pomeranian. And I met a little puppy called Boswell and I thought it was a really cute name. So when I got him, he ended up a Boswell. And it just seemed a big name for a little fellow.
Yeah, but is he going to stay this small?
Yeah, that's it. He's about 14 months old.
Looks sort of fluffy and puppy-like.
Yeah. It's terminal cute.
Terminal cute. Is there anyone else? Do you have human partners?
No, I'm a single parent.
A single parent.
And just Boswell and Coco.
Coco.
Coco, that's the other one.
Yeah. And Coco stays at home?
Most of the time. Or they come to work with me quite often.
What sort of work do you do?
I have a hairdressing salon.
So do they have a role in the salon?
He's managing director of the company.
Uh-huh.
And just floor host, basically. Yeah.
Tell me about hairdressing as a business, as a lifestyle, and how come you're here now this morning, not working?
It's taken me 20 years to work out. I now work wiser, not harder.
Mm-hmm.
Fortunately, it's a large salon. I have about 26 staff, so I don't have to be there all the time,
right.
Which is excellent.
Do you still enjoy it?
I do. I actually retired from hairdressing about 6 years ago. I sold the last salon. Mm-hmm. And then... he's about to bark. No barking, Boz. Well. See, that's what happened. See, it's only because that dog's blonder than him. Isn't it, Bozzy? Cheeky boy. And then I went to a few other businesses and lost millions of dollars, and now it's like back to what I know best.
Right.
So, yeah, it's going extremely well.
What is the motivation in the first place? Is it because you like hairdressing? Is hairdressing itself, or was it the lifestyle?
No, that was a decision made when I was like 15 or 16 years of age.
When you know everything.
Yeah, exactly. And when I was about 16, it was the only job I knew where you could wear what you wanted.
Yes. Yeah. So lifestyle had something to do with it.
Yeah, so that's how it started.
Were you different? Were you a... You know, at school, did you like wear different things?
Yeah, definitely a rebel.
Yeah,
I think.
Without a cause or
without a clue?
Without a clue.
Rebel without a clue, definitely.
Are you still that? Are you still a rebel?
I think so.
Do you know what against?
Just ordinary.
Yeah.
Anything ordinary. I live in a little cottage, well, a large cottage actually, which. Decor wise, I think you'd call it OTT, over the top. I love French antiques and gold gilt pieces, so it's very over the top.
Ornate,
that's me. As well as the business, I do decorating as well. I have a lot of women that come in and buy magnificent homes and ask me to decorate them for them. So.
And you enjoy that?
Yeah, I enjoy that. It's fantastic.
But how do you approach that? I mean, obviously your own taste comes into it, but
yeah.
To what extent?
I think what happens is people, when clients, the salon is very over the top, it's very grand, so, and a lot of people just adore the
decor. This is what I want. Yeah.
So people walk in and say, I love this, and they've just bought a home, and so I basically go out and shop for them on an open checkbook. It's fantastic. I've always, from a child, from small, hated anything ordinary, so... was always attracted to to wealth and excitement and sort of
extraordinary, yeah, larger than life.
Absolutely. Bigger than Ben Hur.
Were you able to enjoy any of that? I mean, were your parents similarly?
I'd say my parents weren't wealthy, but I was brought up fairly comfortably. But for some reason was always, I've always sort of been around wealthy people, so it sort of inspires you to have a certain lifestyle.
And you wanted to be wealthy so you could afford and indulge those tastes?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Which you've achieved.
Yes, yes.
So you're really, you're a success.
No, yeah, I guess so.
What are the things that you still haven't achieved? Is there anything that you still want to achieve?
Yeah, I'd really like to find a life partner.
Have you tried?
Yeah, I've actually been single now for about 8 years.
Yeah.
Only because I think for many years I was too obsessed with making money in business, but I've sort of changed my priorities, but now I've just got to... I don't get out enough, basically. I'm sure there's somebody out there.
When you were,
yeah,
before, you say you've been single, before that, when you weren't single,
yeah,
did that focus on business, did that ruin any relationships, do you think?
No, I don't think so. I just think in my mind it was like, well, when I organise this, then I'm ready for a partner. But you can go on all your entire life sort of putting things off.
Yes.
Yeah.
Is it possible to do anything consciously about meeting someone?
Yeah, I think it means just basically going out and mixing, and occasionally I force myself to go out and I sort of stand in a bar or something and think, God, I was standing here 15 years ago and I'm just looking a lot more tired these days.
You don't sit here, for example, with a sign.
Single, wanted, single. Handsome young man.
But you haven't tried it, have you?
No, I might get a t-shirt printed.
So was that you?
Yes,
was that you
was
up there?
Me, yes.
Do you do your makeup?
That's my bedroom.
And you sit there and let natural light...
So I can see what I'm doing. So yes.
Can we see what you were doing? We can see your lips. What did you put on your eyes?
Mascara. You cheeky guys.
Oh, we are, aren't we?
I know.
I have to ask you this. You're the smartest looking shopper I've ever seen.
You're joking.
You've got your DJs, your dinner jacket on. Are you going shopping?
No, I'm going up to my daughter's house to help tidy up a bit.
Oh, that's very nice. When you're finished with hers, could you come to our place?
I live here 6 months of the year, and 6 months of the year I go back to England.
What part of England?
Bedfordshire, right in the heart.
Right.
So I've only a week to go now. I've been here 5 months and almost the 6 months, so yeah. I've got a week to go and then I go back to England.
They hound you out, do they?
They do, yes. Yes, they're very, very strict now, and the quota for people coming in is very, very small.
Yes.
So I'm sure I'm one of thousands of parents who'd love to come to live here because their children live here, but who can't.
How did it come about that your daughter's living here?
Long story. We have a large family, and one of them came out 35 years ago, and slowly the rest of the family drifted.
Mm.
So I'm the last one left back in Britain.
And your husband?
I am divorced.
You're divorced. So is this for you... how many times have you been here now on this...
Probably 10, yes.
A long time.
Yes, yeah. back and forth. I get the benefit of both worlds.
Do you time it with the climate?
Yes, I can't stand the heat, so I come for your winter, autumn and winter, and that's fine.
So in fact it probably works out quite well.
Well, it does. I mean, Australia is a lot cheaper to live in than England, that's a fact. I'll get quite a shock when I go and do my shopping next week in England. Yes.
What do you do when you go back to England? I mean, are you able to maintain friendships and...
Oh, yes. I mean, it's very important that you do that. And I still carry on a little with my work, although I have retired. And...
What was your work?
I was a theatre director.
Were you?
Yes. Children's professional theatre.
Whereabouts?
In Leighton Buzzard.
Yeah.
And we toured all over the place. So I'm going back to direct Toad of Toad Hall one for Christmas, and then that will be that for the year.
Is that professionally?
Oh yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So you still work a little bit?
Well, I think most people in the arts do. Yeah. You know, they never really retire.
It's not like driving a train and then you stop.
No. You keep your hand in somehow or other.
Yeah. What about, tell us about your daughter and her life out here. She has two children. Is she working?
Yes, yes. She wants the corporate life, and she has two young children. And I think the young people in this country work extremely hard and very long hours. And I'm a bit horrified because it's so different from when I was young and had young children. But it's a good life, and she's happy here.
When they decided to come and live here, and they told you that, what was your reaction to that?
I tried to hide my reaction because I had expected it to happen.
Yeah.
And I was quite heartbroken. Mm. But this happens to lots and lots of people, empty nesters. I have a son who lives and works permanently in Africa, so I've sort of had it happen to me twice.
Mm.
So I have to travel the world to see them.
Mm. How do you relate to your son-in-law?
I'd like to think quite well. I'm a very dominant, quite self-opinionated woman, and I hope that we relate quite well.
You hope. There are no signs that you don't.
No signs at all that we don't. In fact, he says he's going to miss me terribly when I go back, so I think that's rather nice.
Mm.
I think the mother-son-in-law relationship is always an interesting one.
You say you're a dominant, opinionated woman.
Yes.
You were always that way?
I think so, yes.
Yes.
Yes. I was the eldest, and I think, you know, the eldest child syndrome is quite a true one. You know, they are usually used to being in charge because of I had three siblings.
Uh-huh.
So.
Did it ever get you into trouble?
Oh, many, many times. Lots of times. But
not within the family, I mean outside.
Oh yes, yes. You know, if one has strong views about subjects, you must be prepared either to put your money where your mouth is or keep quiet.
Was it always the same sort of subject or everything?
No. I mean, I spent a lot of my life in education and then in theatre in education. Mm-hmm. So in order to produce interesting work, we always worked on contentious subjects and serious subjects as well. So it was very interesting. I mean, we did work on HIV and AIDS and how to explain that 8 years ago to young people when, you know, it was a fairly taboo subject in school.
Yes.
8 to 10 years ago.
And you had a strong opinion about it.
And I had a strong opinion that education was the best prevention.
Mm.
But it was hard because the subject matter was tricky. And
so the people who were opposed to that idea were what sort of people?
Not necessarily opposed to the idea. I think that a lot of people think that children's theatre is only about pantomime and about fairy stories, and they feel that serious subjects like death, bereavement, sexuality, child abuse, bullying, all those subjects perhaps are too contentious to deal with. Well, yeah. I'm of the opposite opinion.
Yes. Is there some kind of a golden rule about children's theatre that you...
Yes, don't patronise them. That's the most important thing, because most children are, you know, I was always taught when I was a young teacher that in every class that you teach, there will be a third of them brighter than you. And most adults forget that. And they talk to five-year-olds as if, you know, they're not intelligent beings, and they are.
Yes.
And so I always work on the premise that half my audience are as bright or if not brighter than I am, and therefore the worst thing you can do is to patronise them.
Your son has children?
No. He's he lives in Africa.
Yes.
And he has a safari business out there, but no, he's not married.
You've bred children who are very different to you in their career paths.
they are both reflections of their parents in different ways, but they're very, very different.
Yes.
Yes.
Running a safari business, do you get to worry about him?
Not so much now that he's got a permanent home, but there have been times when he's been missing in the middle of Africa for months on end, and he has malaria in his blood system, so the thought of him lying on a mat somewhere with malaria used to worry me terribly.
Mm.
But now he's got a home and more of a sort of permanent base with quite a lot of friends, I don't worry as much.
Have you ever been on a safari with him?
Oh yes, and I'm going again for the millennium, so I'm going at Christmas, yes.
Whereabouts?
Victoria Falls, mm-hmm. So I hope to be drinking champagne on the Zambezi for the millennium. That's the plan.
Where are you headed?
I'm just going up to buy vegetable juice. And then,
what sort of vegetable?
Well, I've been going for the beetroot, ginger, celery, carrot, spinach and apple.
All together?
All together.
Wow, that sounds pretty wild.
It tastes like shit, but it's good for you.
Yeah.
puts studs in your nose, I guess.
Well, yeah, might be the one who's
What's
up.
Your name?
I'm Jess.
Jess, hi, yeah. I'm Andrew.
Hi, Andrew.
After the juice, is that a daily thing? Do you do that every
I've
day?
I've been doing it every day for a few weeks.
How did you get onto that combination?
I don't know, I just sort of came up with it, really. Yeah. Just thought I'd throw in as many vegetables as I could.
So this is sort of breakfast?
Kind of, yeah, breakfast on the run.
Keeps you going?
Yeah.
Do you have it any other time of the day?
No, just in the morning usually.
Right.
Yeah.
And then what?
And then I'm off to work.
Yeah, what do you do?
I work in a place down near the city gym, and I feed all the bodybuilders and the gym people.
You feed them?
Well, yeah. They have their carbohydrates, and they come in every couple of hours, and they've been going to work it off at the gym. And
what do you feed? I mean, do you cook or do you?
I'm a waitress, but we serve them tasteless food like boiled chicken and plain rice with egg white omelets and protein shakes with eggs and skim milk and protein powder. So.
Do you ever eat that stuff?
God, no.
How long are your hours? What hours do you work?
I only work 5 hours a day, which is good. Yeah.
And then what do you do?
I go to school on Tuesday and Thursday nights at the Actors Centre.
You're going to be an actor?
Well, I hope
so.
Oh,
you are an actor.
That's the way, That's the thinking I need, yeah.
Let's stop here for a sec.
Okay.
And then and what do you want to do? I mean, how long have you been acting?
Pretty much since I was little, really.
Yeah.
It's all I've ever really wanted to do, yeah.
How are you going to get into it? Do you have any plans?
Well, I'm happy with what I'm doing at the moment, just two nights a week, and I guess it's just keeping my ears open, see what happens. And I'd like to study full time next year, and I'll do the NIDA auditions and the VCA auditions and see what happens.
Do you know why you want to be an actor?
No idea. It's just I think it's just sometimes I feel terribly cursed with the fact that that's my passion in life, because it's such a difficult industry to get into. But I don't know if we choose the things that we really want to do, or whether we're just given the things that we want to do.
What appeals to you about it?
What appeals to me about
it? Is it the acting? Is it the process?
It is. It's the process. It's the awakening of my spirit and the developing of ideas. And, you know, you go on a really personal journey when you start work on a piece. And I guess it's the emotional journey. It's what I'm attracted to, and it's, you know, it's the rush, and it's the extreme, and it's, you know, the opportunity to step out of your normal everyday life and experience things that we wouldn't normally get to experience.
You seem to have a lot of things worked out quite well.
Oh, that's nice to hear. Caught me on a good day.
Yeah, there we go. The juice is working.
Yeah, obviously. Yeah.
The juice is working.